right now will be having a spotlight on the Republic of Congo. So we're very, very excited for that. We'd like to thank our panel sponsors, Xoil, for sponsoring this panel. So thank you so much to our esteemed sponsors. Without further ado, I'd like to kindly introduce our session moderator for today, Mr. Philippe Cohen, who is the Director for Downstream at the African Energy Chamber. Please do take it away, sir.
Well, we're here to learn about the Congolese hydrocarbon sector and its development in the carbon neutral age. We have an interesting panel, very interesting panel. Thank you, Your Excellency, and thank you, Ingvil and Carl, for joining. If you don't mind, I'll ask the first question to Ingvil, because there is a not-so-obvious comparison between the two countries, Norway and the Congo. Well, first of all, it's about the same size in terms of population. And I heard somewhere that perhaps local content was not invented in Africa, but in Norway. So was the first big sovereign fund. So maybe there are some learnings and teachings that we can hear on from you. You're keeping your masks. You're all incognito.
But I'm still not from Senegal, nor is it South Sudan. So it's me behind the mask. Yes, there are some similarities between Norway and Congo. We struck oil for 50 years ago, but we say we, but we didn't do it. It was the Americans who struck oil. We didn't have a clue about the oil and gas industry at that time, but we were a highly competent and educated people. We had a lot of technology and experience from the ocean as a huge fishery nation and also a shipping nation. But we really wanted to know how to deal with the oil and gas industry and to develop the industry. So at that time, it was absolutely a need to have local content in the beginning, to have the experience from the international companies that were invited into Norway and into the Norwegian continental shelf, to learn and teach us what they did. And after some years, we stopped it, because then we had developed industry that had the experience by themselves, and we wanted to have the best technology at the best price. So we opened up for competition from all over the world, international competitors that came and competed with the Norwegian industries and companies. And we developed because of that, and because also of the strict regulations of environment, because we wanted to have the oil and gas industry and combining it side by side with the fisheries, and we wanted the clean air and clean oceans, so that the different industries shouldn't cannibalize each other in a way, both in terms of environment and space. So by that, we developed a highly competitive industry and also world-leading technologies in some areas, because we opened it. So now we don't have the local content anymore, but it was really necessary in the start of the oil and gas industry in Norway.
Thank you very much. I have a question for Minister Itois, and it concerns the 2016 hydrocarbon laws and how this is a step in the right direction, and whether it's going to be for Congo a new start or a good continuation of a trend. Perhaps in view of what we just heard from Norway.
Thank you for your question. I would like again to thank the organizers for this very good opportunity to talk about Congo-Brazzaville. Our first battle is to make sure that the people are not are making difference between the two Congos, because there are two Congos. The first one is DRC, the biggest one, and there is another one, smaller but very nice, which is Congo-Brazzaville, my Congo. The two Congos, they produce oil, but Congo-Brazzaville producing much more. I think we have the third or the fourth one, depending on the data, oil producing country in sub-Saharan Africa. Let me say that at the beginning, the only issue we had is, and I think it's probably the same position for most of the countries, developing countries, is to get back most of the revenues we can have from this industry. After independence, the economic basis of the country was agriculture and the timber industry and some local industry. The day we discover oil, things changed in a drastic way, and oil became the first source of revenue for the country. So it was for us very important to get as much as possible the revenues coming from oil. At the beginning, it was made in a concessional basis. The concession was the first legal base of the relationship between the country and the companies. And then in 1994, we changed the rules and the laws, and then we established the production sharing agreement, the PSA. Because it was presented at that time like the best way to get more revenues for the countries. In fact, I don't think that it changes a lot. So the first battle is not local content, it's not climate change, is how much we can get from this first economic activity of the country, get revenues to solve all the issues, social issues, to provide electricity, water supply, to reduce poverty, and so, to improve education, and then why not to try to establish an economic growth for the country, based on that. That's why we're talking all the time about diversification of the economy, because the oil and gas is taking too much place in our economy until now. Then, moving to get more revenues, we met the issue of the climate change. Climate change brings out the obligation of looking for the best way to remain producing oil. At the time, it was mainly oil, getting more and more revenues, but at the same time, how to reach the climate change issues in our country, especially because our president and really the people who knows about it, really the climate change battles in Africa, they know that President Sassou Nguesso has a kind of passion for these issues. He wrote some books about that. He was a voice of Africa for that after the former minister of Kenya, of Ethiopia. And up to now, he's still battling to preserve the forest, the Congo Basin, establish many things, a found, blue found, many things. So we didn't have any other choice than giving the example of the speech of our president being also applied on the way we're producing oil in our country. That's why in 2007, we decided to stop flaring gas. It was a very historical decision. Decided to stop, not to reduce, to stop flaring gas. Then started a big battle we're still facing with the companies until now, and the current decision of the president, he told me that maybe three days ago, we have to make it be executive, this decision, now. Now, in 2022, we are going to tell our international companies working in our countries that really we need to stop flaring gas. So we're waiting for their proposals, but we're working also with other companies, many, many proposals we have on the table to get it be achieved in our country, stop flaring gas. I don't know if many other countries have really taken this kind of decision by a law or by any rule, any decree or something else. But at the same time, Congo is in the center of Congo Basin, which involves 16 countries. And once again, President is like the champion of that. We trying to preserve, we trying to save the forest. That means if you have to develop the timber industry, we will do it in a way which must be sustainable, under certification, international certification, showing that we're doing that in a sustainable way. And we are known as one of the countries we are doing that in the most sustainable way. That means at the same time, we have to save, to keep a lot of areas where we should be able to let companies work, because we really care about climate change issues. That means we should have some jobs created by that way. We decide to miss jobs for our population by caring, taking care of climate change issues. So today the question is how to do it in a better way. The new decision, first of all, as I said, really stop flaring gas. Secondly, bringing all the petroleum company to be more involved and committed in gas industry, which wasn't really not developed in our country. This is a new target, this is a new challenge in the country. Why? Because we feel, but I don't think that we're the only one to say that, gas is probably the first step of moving to a new era for clean energy. It's gas. So we're working on a gas law. It's almost achieved, a new one. We're working to change rules about oil industry to bring companies to be more involved in gas. We already have a power plant, a gas power plant, and we have on my table a new project to bring it from 400 megawatt to 1,000, and the next step will be maybe 2,000, why not 3,000? We need gas for industry. We need gas for our population because the access to gas is very bad. And we think we have now the potential to develop LNG industry as one of the second or the most important issues and targets for oil and gas industry in the country. So we think that all the conditions now are on the table to bring companies to be more involved and committed for gas, for gas in the country, and it's the first step to change the mind, to change the way we're working on the energy sector. Now we need to work on the legal and the fiscal routes in order to make it the more attractive we can, and then we will have all the conditions to be a gas player in Central Africa, and why not in Africa. But at the same time, and I will conclude by that, by that. The name of the country is Congo. This name comes from Congo River, which we share with DRC, the second biggest river in the world. The the hydropower potential of Congo River is one of the most important in the world. We are a renewable energy country player. I said this morning that the potential of hydropower, which is used in my country, is 3%. We're using 3% of the potential. So we have everything. And in the same time, the new strategy is promoting solar energy at the same time. We have all the conditions to be a very good solution for the new era of a low carbon energy, why not a net zero energy? And I think we're going to launch a Congo Grid initiative, including the new strategy for having low carbon, why not net zero energy in the country. That's what I can say at the beginning of this session and panel. If you have any question, I'm really available for you to give you any clarification you need. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Excellency. You mentioned the carbon capture and forest. I think that's also a big alternative to and compensation to all the oil and gas that will be kept as an industry in your country. It's I've seen the announcement by Total, and I'm sure there will be others. It's a very important aspect, creating forests, compensating with the carbon capture there, I think that's very good. Thank you for your encompassing presentation. May I ask Carl Rogatien to talk a little bit about refinery projects. Est-ce que vous voulez, Carl Rogatien, parler un peu du raffinage, de projet de raffinerie nouvelle? Do people have? Vous allez parler en français? I can do translation. I don't know what the rule is here. I can translate a little bit. We can all translate. But you also have some translating kits on the tables. À vous.
Merci et bonjour à tous. Alors, le monde pétrolier aujourd'hui, lorsqu'on prend les activités du secteur pétrolier en amont, en termes de projet, hein, et les activités du secteur pétrolier aval, il s'observe d'emblée que les niveaux d'engagement traduisent le plus souvent les degrés d'engagement des entreprises et des États. Pourquoi ? Tout simplement parce que sur ce double plan, les volontés consistent à booster les efforts déployés en vue d'aller rapidement, en tout cas pour chacun, vers les résultats escomptés en termes de production, lorsque c'est le cas, ou en termes d'augmentation des capacités, par exemple.
Et donc, just to summarize quickly, the upstream activities are key to developing all the capacities and are at the heart of the policing of the government you're going to develop that.
Voilà. Donc cela s'explique par le simple fait que toutes les entités, hein, privées et publiques, engagées dans cette dynamique, travaillent à améliorer, hein, ou l'outil de production ou donc les conditions de travail, mais dans le but précis d'aller rapidement vers les résultats escomptés en termes de rendement. C'est ce qui s'est traduit au niveau Oui, de l'amont pétrolier par des projets d'exploration, des projets d'amélioration de la condition de travail et avec au bout donc la nécessité d'être efficace, sinon d'être plus efficace. Chez nous, au niveau national, il y a des projets qui ont été lancés depuis un petit moment, qui commencent à porter des fruits en termes de production ou d'évolution positive de la production. Il y a également, au niveau toujours de l'amont pétrolier, des projets en cours qui vont donc connaître un début d'action. Pour ce qui concerne
le raffinage,
le secteur de l'aval pétrolier, et en l'occurrence du raffinage, il y a à ce niveau-là des impératifs en termes de capacité de maintenir en bon état de fonctionnement l'outil de travail de façon à pouvoir mettre sur le marché des produits de bonne qualité et en quantité suffisante pour couvrir les besoins de consommation nationale, allusion à la chaîne du Congo, sinon les besoins de consommation d'un marché bien précis. Et donc pour aller rapidement dans ce sens, des actions sont entreprises dans le développement ici. Je vous prends régulièrement les cas que nous avons au niveau national congolais. Donc des outils de mise à niveau sont mis en place en termes organisationnels, mais en termes de réhabilitation, sinon de relèvement des capacités de l'usine, hein, des unités de production en interne. Et donc, je vous laisse traduire ou je continue.
On m'a dit que la traduction marchait.
Ah, ben, très bien.
I've been told by NJ that translation is in order.
Thank you.
So I have one question because the minister mentioned the regional vocation of Congo, and I can see that on the refining and product distribution, you also are at the key location where you could supply Cameroon, which has no longer got a refinery. You can supply DRC, you can supply Central African Republic. Je traduis pour vous, vous avez compris? C'est bon.
Il faut dire que le Congo aujourd'hui n'est pas dans la possibilité, au jour d'aujourd'hui, avec le dispositif en place, le système en place, n'est pas encore en mesure de fournir les produits dans la sous-région. C'est plutôt le contraire. Nous travaillons avec des commandes que la CORAF arrive à satisfaire, mais pas à 100%. Mais nous avons, au niveau national, des projets, des mesures qui ont été prises pour relever toutes les capacités possibles pour aller vers cet objectif-là. Et évidemment, c'est dans ce cadre que s'inscrit le projet de construction d'une nouvelle raffinerie d'une capacité de 2,5 millions tonnes an. Et donc, ce projet a été donc lancé quasiment récemment. Et des études sont en cours pour donc aller vers concrètement la réalisation de ce projet de façon à être en mesure en ce moment-là d'aller toucher la sous-région pour pouvoir mettre à disposition les volumes supplémentaires qui pourraient survenir en plus de ce qu'on aura mis sur le marché national, à apporter les volumes additionnels dans les pays voisins, pourquoi pas.
And that would be in Pointe Noire. Oui, of course.
Je vais continuer en français. Comme ça, Karl ne sera pas isolé. Alors, je voulais dire deux, trois choses. La première, c'est que après la période post-coloniale, beaucoup de pays africains ont construit des raffineries pour leurs marchés locaux. Et donc des petites raffineries. Et évidemment, tous ces pays ont eu de grandes difficultés avec ces petites raffineries parce que tout le monde sait, quand on est connaisseur du secteur de l'aval pétrolier et du raffinage, que les marges de raffinage sont en général très faibles. Elles sont coincées entre les prix du brut qui dépendent du marché et ceux qui vendent le brut se battent pour qu'il soit vendu à un prix élevé. Personne n'a envie qu'il soit bas pour ceux qui produisent. Ce sont les consommateurs qui le souhaitent. Donc les raffineurs sont coincés entre des prix de brut qui sont souvent très élevés et des prix des produits pétroliers qui ont un impact social tellement important que rarement on pratique la vérité de prix. Dans mon pays, nous avons les mêmes prix depuis, je ne sais pas, presque 20 ans. Et on ne peut pas les bouger parce que ça aurait un impact à la fois social et économique tellement important qu'on ne veut pas les bouger. Donc les marges de raffinage sont en général très faibles. Les raffineurs gagnent sur le volume. Plus on raffine, même avec des marges faibles, et plus on gagne de l'argent. Donc les raffineries de faible capacité, en général, elles sont difficilement rentables. C'est un mauvais choix que, entre guillemets, ou les colons nous ont laissé, ou les administrations post-coloniales ont fait, que d'avoir de façon disséminée dans chaque pays des petites raffineries. L'intérêt de l'Afrique est de construire en Afrique de grandes raffineries intégrées pour la sous-région, pour plus que la sous-région. Et on pourrait imaginer que dans le golfe de Guinée, où presque tout le monde produit du pétrole, on ait une, deux, trois grandes raffineries au service de tout le monde. La preuve, quand nous importons des produits pétroliers, nous ne les importons pas d'Afrique, car le Ngakala est le patron de l'aval pétrolier congolais. Il a fait tous les métiers là-bas, de l'aval pétrolier de la SNPC, pardon. Il a fait tous les métiers là-bas. On les importe de partout. On va voir les traders, ils vont venir de partout. Donc, à la limite, peu importe où est la grande raffinerie, qu'elle soit au Congo, Gabon, Cameroun, au Nigeria, au Sénégal ou en Côte d'Ivoire, peu importe. Peu importe. Si c'est une décision commune de créer les conditions pour que les raffineries gagnent de l'argent et d'investir, on peut très bien avoir des raffineries dans lesquelles tous ces pays sont actionnaires ou les compagnies nationales sont actionnaires. C'est probablement la meilleure façon de développer le raffinage en Afrique. Si nous voulons être en compétition avec les grandes raffineries européennes, les grandes raffineries d'Asie, il faut être grande raffinerie africaine. Sinon, on n'a aucune chance. Aucune chance. Par ailleurs, quand on a une petite raffinerie, quand on a un marché local étroit, où est-ce qu'on va trouver les ressources pour financer tout le process? Les viscoréducteurs, l'hydrocracking, toutes ces choses qui permettent d'améliorer les rendements, de réduire les taux de perte. Où est-ce qu'on va trouver des ressources alors qu'on a un tout petit marché local? Le Congo, c'est 5 millions d'habitants, c'est rien du tout. La Guinée équatoriale, le Gabon, l'Angola, c'est des pays à très faible population, donc des marchés très faibles. Donc, plusieurs pays du golfe de Guinée, y compris le Congo, je crois que l'Angola aussi y a travaillé à un moment donné, à l'image de la cire en Côte d'Ivoire, qui déjà commence à avoir une taille respectable, puisqu'elle sert essentiellement presque tous les pays d'Afrique de l'Ouest, quelques pays africains travaillent pour avoir de vraies plateformes de raffinage quelque part dans nos pays. Je ne sais pas si tout le monde sait que l'une des plus grandes plateformes de raffinage au monde se trouve à Singapour, qui ne produit pas une goutte de pétrole. Ils ont juste créé les conditions. Donc oui, le Congo vise à être une plateforme de raffinage pour la sous-région, voire au-delà, être simplement une plateforme internationale de raffinage. C'est un objectif qui est inscrit dans la création de la zone économique spéciale. Nous allons créer les conditions là-bas, avec des taxes très faibles, avec des lois très attractives, pour, on l'espère, attirer des raffineurs. Et on est content parce qu'il y en a un qui est déjà là, qui vient avec une nouvelle raffinerie dont on a parlé, qui produira 2,5 fois plus que la raffinerie actuelle. Donc on va tripler la capacité actuelle, mais ce n'est pas suffisant. Nous pensons que la bonne taille, c'est environ 10 000 tonnes par an de capacité. Et c'est à ce moment-là qu'on va commencer à devenir vraiment intéressant et rentable. Pour ça, on développe l'électricité, pour qu'il y en ait. On développe tout ce qui est numérique, pour qu'au niveau TIC, il y ait le meilleur environnement possible. Nous avons un des ports en eau profonde les plus importants de toute la côte ouest, Donc avec ça, nous pensons qu'on a toutes les conditions pour que, pourquoi pas, le Congo devienne une grande plateforme de raffinage. Nous pensons qu'on a plus d'atouts que Singapour. Donc votre question est très très pertinente. Merci.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. Ingvild, as former Undersecretary of Energy of Norway, do you have any things to add on, you know, the current state of refineries, the reconversion of refineries in a country that's not going to be using much petrol anymore? And any suggestions for the Congo?
Well, I'd love to have some very good answers to that, but I don't actually have them. But I really do see the challenges of exporting all the gas that you're producing in your own country and not being able to use it. We do that in Norway as well. We export. I think we withhold like 1 or 2% of what we produce in Norway to the Norwegian consumers, but that's because our total energy mix is like 70% of renewables, and our electricity system contains of 98% of renewables as well. That's because it rains a lot in Norway, so we have a lot of hydropower, so we're blessed with that. Having that said, I do believe that the resources, natural resources in a country, belongs to the people of the country, to the country itself. And that's really important. And we have something to learn of that in Norway as well. Because to refine your own resources, we can see that within the fisheries that we have, we sell the fish, the raw material, out to other countries, and we buy it back as fishery products. It's and the value creation is lost. It's given away to other countries. And I think we can look at that at the same way with the gas and the oil and natural resources as a whole. It should be kept within the country and then sold as either as a part of developing industry in the country, where you use the power to produce another product and then sell it, because then you can have more jobs, more experienced people to produce even more produces to export. So these are really huge and difficult questions. What we also did, well, I have to speak from a Norwegian term, being a Norwegian, of course. What we also, I think, was really needed in the Norwegian shelf was that we were able to have stable and predictable framework conditions on long terms, because of investment into this industry, it takes 8 to 10 years before you have any income back from it. We also developed a tax system where you have 75% reduction of the investments you do, but you pay 78% tax of all the income to the oil and gas companies. So you know that that's what developed the sovereign wealth fund. It was a tax system. And we are alike with Congo in many ways. Also, we are 5 million inhabitants. 200,000 of those are working within the oil and gas industry. So we are very independent in a way, or dependent on the oil and gas industry, making us vulnerable. And we see that, well, now the gas is really high due to the situation all over the world. But you know, having closing up, as many of the environmentalists in Norway as well want us to do, they want us to close down the whole Norwegian continental shelf. And it will put us in a very, very difficult situation. And being a former politician, I can say this now, I'm very against it. I do think that we should get use of all the resources we have in the country, but we have to do it sustainable. And there's a lot of opportunities to do that now. In the 4 years I was, when I was a deputy minister, I was politically in charge of the CCS project, the only full-scale carbon capture and storage project in the world. Because we saw this transition coming and we needed to do something about the CO2 situation. So what we did there was to use the knowledge we had in the country, because we have been banned, have a ban to flare for 50 years, making us developing technology to take care of the gas, handle the gas, and to also use it as IOR, or enhanced and increased oil recovery. So our percentage of that is like 42% recovery of the fields, which is really high. So it's made us step by step getting better to these things. But then again, we had a quite different economy when we found out than Congo. The situation between Norway and Congo is not comparable in those matters. But I do think that the resources should be developed, kept and sold as other producers than it is now. It belongs to Congo and the Congolese people.
Thank you very much. I think we're running out of time, but Your Excellency, maybe you won't have le mot de la fin.
Thank you. Maybe before you question, I will add just something, and then I try to do it in a short time, and then maybe you will have more information before asking a question. I would like to say, just maybe to conclude the presentation on Congo, what are today our challenges? The first one, and really thanks for the sharing the experience of Norway, which we know. When you work for oil activity, you if you don't know Norway experience, you know nothing. So we know. And the first challenge is right to improve governance, good governance, and the transparency in the way we managing oil and gas. Now we say oil and gas, really, in our country. We are a member of ETA, and all the time we have the audit made by ETA, and this is shared on the network of ETA, so you can have an access of all the data and the condition, the revenues, and so, which is brought by oil and gas activity. This is really the first challenge, and we're working all the time to improve it. About local content, I didn't say anything about that. Yes, it's a big challenge. Now everyone says local content. In fact, it's not just a question of content, of local content, no. It's the local impact of the oil and gas industry on the population. Is it enough? How to improve it? How to accelerate? And we really think that the first local content initiative of the country is our national oil company, Carl belongs to, and I was the first chairman and CEO of the company. And this is the first way to have more commitment and involvement of the population and the Congolese people in oil and gas industry. Today, the company, by the law, the hydrocarbons law, is the one who have all the mining the permit in our country. But after doing that, they have to find partners. They have to set up with the ministry and association, with international oil companies. Now in the law, there is an obligation of giving some part to local oil company, very small one, but there is an obligation. There is a minimum they must have in the association in our country now. So we have now 2, 3, 4, 5 maybe small private Congolese companies involved in oil and gas industry. Today, our challenge is to produce more, yes, because we still need the revenues to develop and diversify our economy, and this revenue will come from oil and gas, but in a better way. That's why we're talking on oil and gas now. We have the big challenge of the downstream. And the downstream is very important. Why? Because downstream is directly linked to population life in a daily basis. That's what Carl was trying to explain to you. It's a big, big issue for us, how to improve the access for the population to modern cooking gas. It's not nothing for us. It's not a joke. It's very serious. It means how to improve the way the lifestyle of the population. So the downstream is a big issue for us. And when we talk downstream, midstream, you have the refinery issues which take place on our strategy. But I would like to say that, after saying that, we still have three blocks. Three blocks for oil, and most importantly, three blocks for gas. Because now we're working strongly for gas. We had a hydrocarbon laws in 2016. We're working on that to make it be more attractive. We're working on a gas laws in order to make it be very attractive. We have a master gas plan which was led by our national company. If you go to our stand, you can have more details and explanation about that, how to come and invest in gas industry in Congo now. And in the downstream industry, it's a totally privatized activity. Any private company can come here, come in Congo, and ask for having an agreement, a license, and start working in Congo Brazzaville. And at least but not last, I think we are one of the most stable politically country in the country. Thank you. In the continent. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Did you have one comment before we have one question with the gentleman in grey over there?
Excuse me. One word. I'm really strongly interested by the experience of sovereign found in Norway. I'm ready to send a team to your country if you can agree to receive them, because we're trying to set up the same thing. Thank you.
Can you just explain who you represent?
Absolutely. We have one question. Please, may you kindly keep it brief as we're running out of time.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, my name is Jackson Njoka. I own an inspection company. I do quality and quantity control of petroleum products. We've been having some issues in Koraf, that when we discharge products over there, the lab is always failing the products, which when we discharge from the same shipment in other countries, it goes through. So I just want to ask Calvin if he's going to do anything to improve the lab, Koraf, to meet the standards of other labs around. Bon, je peux encore parler en français. Pour moi, je m'appelle Jackson Njoka. J'ai une société d'inspection, souvent quand on décharge des produits à Pointe-Noire. Il y a souvent Koraf qui nous déclare ce produit, pourtant ça passe dans d'autres pays. Bon, les mêmes produits qui sortent dans le même navire. Bon, je voulais savoir si vous allez tout faire pour améliorer votre laboratoire de Koraf.
Merci pour la question. Merci pour votre question. Faut déjà que je vous rappelle que les produits qui circulent sur le territoire national congolais sont réglementés en termes de qualité. Il y a un décret qui donc encadre scrupuleusement la qualité des produits qui circulent sur le territoire national. Et lorsque vous recevez de la part d'un quelconque partenaire commercial, dans le sens de livrer des produits au Congo, demandez-leur de vous fournir les spécifications nationales des produits pétroliers autorisés à être mis sur le marché au Congo. Cela vous permettra d'avoir dans le détail les points de spécification qui vont vous permettre ou qui vont vous mettre à l'abri d'avoir à livrer un produit qui soit non conforme. Et les produits qui sont consommés sur le territoire congolais sont certifiés conformes par un laboratoire indépendant, celui de la raffinerie. Hein, donc, lorsque les produits ne sont pas conformes, ces produits sont interdits d'être mis à la consommation. Il arrive très, très, très rarement que même les produits CORAF, lorsqu'ils sont fabriqués et avant le transfert dans les bacs commerciaux, et lorsque le laboratoire établit que le produit est non conforme sur parfois un point ou deux, ce produit doit subir un retraitement hein, avec, j'imagine, des additifs hein, pour pouvoir porter la qualité au niveau standard requis par l'industrie. Pas seulement au Congo, mais par l'industrie. Donc, je ne sais pas quels sont les points de qualité qui ne sont pas conformes au niveau des produits qu'il vous arrive de livrer hein, sur, plutôt au Congo. Mais dès lors que le produit n'est pas conforme, il y a un décret qui interdit sa réception sur le territoire national. Donc, voilà déjà ce que je peux vous dire en termes de qualité. Hein, ces spécifications qui vous seront transmises sur simple demande vous mettront, je pense, à l'abri de ces désagréments. Merci.
Thank you.
I want to add something, just quickly, because he was saying, he was suggesting us, he was asking us when we will improve the lab. But the lab of the refinery, I don't know if it needs to be improved because today they have all the agreement, international agreement, all the certification, ISO 9000 and so and so and so and so. So the question, is it the question of improving the lab way of working, or is it your product which must be conform to the certification? Maybe you should check more efficiently your product before bringing it in the country. I'm not sure that is a question of a lab of a refinery, which is really today known as one of the best one in the sub-region. Thank you.
Thank you very much. One last word.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention what His Excellency said about small private oil companies in Congo. I'm representing one of them as well, Petronor. And we would absolutely line up for the gas as well, the licenses as gas. I just have to mention that, being so close to you. And I just have to brag a little bit about Congo as well, because we are experiencing excellent frameworks with Congo, working together with them on the licenses that we have in Congo and in Africa as a whole as well. So your Excellency, thank you so much for that.
That's very encouraging. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Excellency. Thank you, Ingvild. Thank you, Carl. We don't have any more time for questions, I think.
Merci. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you so much to His Excellency, our esteemed speakers. Give a round of applause. What a wonderful session. Amazing. All right.